is Coptic jars. They are Egyptian. These jars were used to place the organs of the deceased. The Egyptians believed that all body parts would be reunited in the afterlife, and the body would become whole again. The stoppers of the Coptic jars, which are the top part, were shaped like the heads of the four sons of Horus. And these are his four sons. I'm not even going to attempt to say their names. So they are the jackal, which held the stomach, the hawk, which held the intestines, and the baboon held the lungs, and the man the liver. So, the hawk, the jackal, and the baboon. Canopic jars were made of many different things, and in many different styles. These are King Tut's canopic jars, and they're made of alabaster, which is a stone. So they would have been carved out of the stone completely. Later on down the line, over time they evolved in different ways they made them. Here they're made out of wood. You can tell, instead of having the jar open from the top, they open from the side, just like the tomb would have been. Then on the bottom part, you have hieroglyphics, and then the face of the deceased on the top. So these are not the sons of Horus, these are the image of the man in the tomb. And here are other examples of the four sons of Horus. Also, this shows you on the lid, you need a lip. So here's the lip, just like we talked about last class on any clay project. And then up here, you create a ledge. That way this sits down inside of it. If you didn't put the ledge, it would fall straight in the hole. Then it wouldn't be a lid anymore. And then this just says that many of these jars have hieroglyphics. They were writings about the individual. It told their status, where they lived, who they were, who their family were. And that's all contained in these images up here at the bottom. On your jars, on your handouts, there's a page with hieroglyphics, the alphabet, and just some common ones. If you choose to recreate one of the four sons of Horus and put your own spin on them, use hieroglyphics at the bottom. You can create a pattern at the bottom or other symbols. If you do something different, like you have the choice to do any animal that you would like. So you could do like a grizzly bear. And on the bottom you could put Native American symbols if you would like. Or you could do a giraffe and put African symbols. Or you don't have to put symbols at all, you can just do a design that goes with your animal or your person, whatever you'd like to do. And coffee jars, you can now see them in museums. I'm not certain if the IMA has any or not. It's been a long time since we've been there. But they are common, they're found. In your handout, you'll read that. It's like a bad omen to steal a canopic jar. You would be cursed if you took the parts to another human being, considering they're supposed to be reunited with the body that's in the tomb. And here's some close-up views of the heads on the canopic jars. And once again, you have the human, the hawk, the jackal, and the baboon. Who can tell me the four organs that they removed? Lungs, liver, intestines, and what are the two that they don't keep?
The heart
and the brain. Why? Riley?
They don't remove the heart because it's considered the center of the soul and it's considered an intelligence and emotion.
Right. So they do what with it?
They leave it in the body.
Leave it in the body. What do they wash these with?
White wine.
What are the four sons of Let's see. Do you guys have any other questions about these?
No, ma'am.
Okay, hit this page, which I'll copy it for you if you tell me after this. And Bella, you have it to put in your tote tray. But down here at the bottom is just the alphabet in hieroglyphics. And then up here at the top are some common ones that are seen throughout Egyptian monuments. Obviously, we don't have the definitions for every single one of these for you, but if something looks neat to you, you can use it. On the following page, you have some different variations of the four suns. And you can see the different shapes in the jar themselves. The ones at the top are more slender at the bottom. The ones at the bottom are more just like a jar. These over here to the side, they aren't jars at all. I just believe they're statues of the four suns, of course.
Do they all open?
Yeah, they would all open. These open at the top. Like, this is what you'll be doing. And they open this way. The ones that I showed you earlier from King Tut's tomb, they were wooden and they laid on their side and opened like a tomb. No, I believe Mrs. Connolly made this one.
It looks almost like a unicorn. It's a horse.
So now, what you're going to do is, I'm going to pass out these sheets for you. And there's four base for you to sketch on. And I want you to use detail to think about it as a three-dimensional shape, not just a flat piece of paper. You can choose any animal that you think represents you or relates to you or that's your favorite. You can do a person of any sort, just like one of the sons of Horus is human. You can do it. You can recreate the sons of Horus in your own form. You can do a mythical creature, but you can't do objects and you can't use words or numbers. So on the bottom, you can't put like the Nike symbol or something. You can't write your name, but be creative with these. You could do a giraffe and on the bottom have some kind of African design.
Can you do a car?
Or lines.
No.
You can't do a car because that's an object. So you can do animals or people. Also another thing, let me hold this up here. I don't know how well you can see these, but I drew some examples up here. Anything you do, like if you do an elephant, you can't have the ears sticking out from the jar because they'll break really easy. If you put ears on something, they have to be short, kind of stubby, because you know, they can break easily. Because you will be opening and closing these. So if you do something with wings, you want them to be able to wrap around the object. Or if it has legs or a tail, you can build them on top and wrap it around. But you don't want anything huge sticking off. That's the reason why we were doing the sketches, so you can come up with at least four good ideas. Here I drew an octopus. So you have the top and the legs holding down over the bottom. This is a phoenix. It has the wings wrapping around and then the fiery tail on the back. And once you carve these, we'll fire them and then you'll glaze them. So you'll be able to make them bright, colorful if you want. We have a penguin, an elephant, a pig, and then this here is a ladybug. So you would just design the bottom of the jar. The top, she had it as a leaf folding over the jar. And then a ladybug sitting on the top. So there's endless possibilities. She said someone in the past had done like a hippie looking person and then on the bottom put like peace and love and flowers and whatever. So it's up to you, but I want you to be very creative with these. Please try to detail your sketches. I'm gonna collect these and grade them, not for a grade for Mrs. Connolly, but a grade for me. And then next time when we get together, you will talk about your four sketches at your table, and you'll choose your favorite one, and that's the one that you will resketch and then design in the clay. And then this is called wedging. We talked about it this Monday. And we said that you have to wedge clay to do what?
Get all the air bubbles out.
Air bubbles, what else?
Objects.
Objects and water. Well, this clay is straight from the bag, straight from the box, so it's already been wedged, so there shouldn't be very many air bubbles. But we're still going to mix it up and get it going. So to wedge clay, the important thing is to push it down with your heels and to pull it back to you, not to fold it over, because when you fold it over, you're folding air bubbles into it. So, for purpose sake here, we're gonna fold it over and make air bubbles. So you're going to hit it really hard with the palm of your hand. And we're just gonna fold it over a bunch. When you hit it, you're working the air bubbles to the surface, and you can hear them pop sometimes. Then you're going to cut it here, and I don't see any air bubbles. So I didn't do a good enough job creating air bubbles, so let's make some more.
Is that like a rope?
Yeah, it's just a piece of wire. So does anyone remember, like, workable clay, what it's called when you can move it really easily?
Plastic.
Plastic. Good job, Sam.
Bingo.
Okay, so if it's plastic, it's really bendable. That's what you want right now. You can kind of see here. It'll look like little dips, or once you start working on it, the bubbles will come up from underneath, and they'll be like, it'll look like it's trying to bubble out, like when you blow your bubble gum. But you're each going to get enough, a little more than this, so that your hands should just barely meet. And it'll be enough for you to get started.
Are we getting it today?
Yes, you're all going to get this today. So you're just going to push it back, pull it towards you. Push it back, pull it towards you.
I haven't drawn off my discussion.
We can only do two people at a time for this, so while some of you are doing this, the rest of you can be working on your sketches. So, you two, you can stay and rest if you go back and start, and then, oh, another part real quick, you're going to spray this with water and then put it in a trash bag. Put your name on the trash bag and put it in your tote tray.